I don't know whether or not you know this, but we've been servicing the Hema Maps 76 Land Cruiser for some time now. And I did say to Justin a couple of services ago that I was getting a bit concerned on the condition of the engine, in particular the injector knock that was there. It was developing a few oil leaks, and I suggested to Justin that at least as a minimum we would put a new injector pump and set of injectors and lines on it. But to do the job properly, given the kilometres that were on the engine, it would be a good idea for a number of reasons to look at reconditioning the engine. When you're looking at your VDJ and wondering whether or not you should recondition it, there are a number of things to look for, and any good competent mechanic should be able to give you a fairly accurate assessment on the condition of the engine. So we had a chat, and it was decided then that instead of waiting 4 years for a new car, it would be a better option to do up the one you had. You've got history with a car, bringing that back to brand new spec. The same with the gearbox, the transfer case, the front differential, the rear differential. Turn it into a pre-loved newish car that's going to give you 10 to 15, even maybe 20 years of good service, so long as it's serviced properly and at the right times. One of the things that we look for when we're servicing a vehicle is we always take an oil sample out of the car prior to doing an engine flush. And that tells me the condition, basically, of the internal componentry on the engine. Now, from that I mean any forced air inducted engine, which this is, it's a diesel, so it's running on very high compression and it's got a turbocharger on it, delivering more than atmospheric pressure to the combustion chamber. As an engine wears, you get a lot of blow-by, and in that blow-by there's minute particles of diesel. That diesel gets into the engine oil and makes the oil jellify. All engines do breathe a bit, and you'll notice most people now are trying to fit catch cans to their diesel engines, and that's for the reason that there is a lot of engine blow-by in a forced air inducted engine, whether it's supercharged or turbocharged. And to keep that oil out of the inlet cycle, we allow it to breathe into a canister that's remote from the engine. There's an engine knock you get. When your injectors are wearing out, there is a combustion knock. Diesel engines these days have got the combustion chamber basically in the crown of the piston. So as that piston's going down, as it starts to go down, the injector fires the diesel into the combustion chamber, which is in the crown of the piston. It ignites through compression, and there's a thrust moment down on that piston, and then as it's coming up, it's building compression up, but the conrod's pushing the piston to one side, so you get wear generally on the side of the piston. Well, what happens as the engine wears, and all engines wear eventually, you get a lot of piston slap, so there's a noise you hear there. The other thing that people may or may not understand is that that conrod that's connected to the crankshaft has a steel bearing with an aluminium coating, and sometimes Babbitt or aluminium as the primary coating, and that's the one that, if it's going to come into contact with the journal on the crankshaft, that's the one that first wears. And as you can see on this bearing, it's worn the primary coating off it back to the copper backing. Okay, so it wouldn't be too much longer before this engine will have a rather nasty little end knock. You have a look at the head gasket. The head gasket's a pretty plain looking unit, but you get so much out of a head gasket by reading it. Now, these aren't a composite head gasket. Most diesel engines these days, and I say most because some do use a composite gasket, most diesel engines all run a shim style gasket. The things you're looking for is leakage on the sealing area on the head gasket, which is just around the very edge. And you'll see a dark area where the head gasket may be blown, okay? And you'll look for the water galleries and the oil ports to make sure they've been sealing okay, and that's good. That gasket's been doing its job well. There's been no leakage of compression from one cylinder to another. There's been no cooling system failure there. All the oil ports are fine. So this means that The cylinder heads were bolted on very well onto the block and everything was sealing and doing its job properly. So with all these things said and done, it doesn't take a lot of work to realise that an engine's at a stage where it needs to be reconditioned or replaced. And we know the injectors need replacing. They've passed their use-by date. You should really replace them in a VDJ every 150,000 Ks. There's a brand new injector there, okay, and we use injectors from Denso, and we get them from a company called Cornell Diesel. Cornell's would be the most elaborate and technically capable injector builders and pump rebuilders in Australia. Their facility is second to none. And with the fueling system on a diesel, given that these things run at such high fuel pressure, and it's up around 30,000 PSI, given that the nozzle on the injector is the business end, which is this end here, it's got tiny little holes in there you can't even see with a naked eye, and they're cut in there with a laser. Now, the very end shape of that hole is critical in determining the spray pattern and the atomization of the diesel fuel. The problem is, though, these little holes are cut with a laser when they're made. After they've done 150,000 Ks, the hole's out of shape, the end of the nozzle hole is out of shape, so you don't get even distribution of the fuel over the crown of the piston. Now, if you have a look at these two pistons, out of the same engine, different injectors, you'll see this piston here has a different burn pattern than this piston here. And you can tell by the carbon deposit, okay, which is realistically a low pressure area, over the crown of the piston, okay, and the high pressure area is the aluminium or lighter colour, and that's where the carbon's been washed out from the jet of fuel coming out of the injector. We wouldn't reuse these pistons for a couple of reasons. One is they've suffered a lot of thermal stress over 150,000 or 200,000 or 300,000, however many Ks your engine's done. We can see that some pistons have been running slightly hotter than others. The cooling system on the engines work very well. The next step we do is when we pull the pistons out and rod assemblies, the conrods aren't connected to these, neither are the gudgeon pins in there, but with the conrod connected in there and the gudgeon pin, we would try and move the piston sideways. And if there's any movement there, we know that the conrods will need the little ends rebushed. And that's what was done with the conrods in the VDJ. We would check the conrods for straightness, and with the bearing cap screwed onto the conrod under tension, we measure the if there's any ovality out of the conrods. So the column load on those little ends is quite extreme, so they tend to go oval. So what you need to do is where the two halves of the bearing cap go together, you machine them down, and then you rebore the conrod out to get it a nice round surface for the bearing to sit in, okay? And then you check and make sure that you've got enough clearance between the bearing and the crankshaft journal to allow the oil to fill that space so you don't have the bearing touching the crankshaft, okay? Once you've got your piston and rod sorted out, you look at the bore, measure the bore up and check it for taper and also ovality, because the bores will wear on a taper. Also, they'll wear because you've got the thrust faces of the pistons are there, the piston will rock in the bore, okay, and that actually wears the bore out that way. So in this case, we had to bore the block, put new pistons, new piston rings, resize the conrods, put new bearings in, put new little end bearings, which is where the gudgeon pin goes in through the conrod, to attach the piston, they were put in, the new ones are those, new oil pump. The top of this block was decked anyway. That's good common practice to do that. Now the cylinder heads, they're pretty good on these VDJs. They weren't cracked, they were surfaced, all the valves were done, seats recut, the bucket and shim sizes were all reshimmed and done to the correct clearance. on the tappets for the camshafts. And that's about that. Now with the crankshaft's measured up and checked for ovality and any grooves in it. So the crankshaft was linished on this. It was in really good condition. No major damage, although some of the main bearings had grooves in them. That's that particular bearing there is a good bearing. There's no grooving in there, which means not too much contamination got through the oil filter into the oil passage, which is a good sign. And also, we also check the back of the bearing too. All the stuff for this engine now, in its genuine format, is available aftermarket. And one of the key things is getting onto a good, reliable company that imports all these quality components into Australia. So the things we look at are pistons have got to be genuine. Guide rails for your timing chains, got to be genuine. Your chains have got to be genuine. They're made out of good steel. The design of them's perfect. Chains get a lot of wear in them. All the retaining washers for the fuel delivery lines on the injectors are all genuine Toyota. And like, they're that precise, just that little fragile bracket, they put it in a foam block so it maintains its shape. So we use as much genuine componentry as we can, or genuine sourced manufacturers for the engine components. I mean, you can cut the cost of doing this engine up by probably a couple of $1,000 by using non-genuine style componentry. You know, a lot of people say they can recondition these injectors. There's very few people in Australia that are capable of that because the machinery required is worth millions of dollars. So that's why we use Cornell. If it's done properly and all the correct parts are used, you should get a very long trouble-free life out of the engine. I'll tell you what the deal is. If you go with the original style units, you can't get better on a diesel engine because no one makes, realistically, that much of a difference of a better piston for a diesel engine than the OE manufacturers, because they're the ones that have got to guarantee it for 100,000K. If they don't get it right, it costs them a lot of money. Now, I know they build a failure factor into every car they sell. They allow probably 5% of the cost of the car in warranty. So it's within their interest to have the car going flawlessly for at least 100,000 Ks, because the least amount of warranty work they have to perform, the greater the profit the bottom line is, and that's what it's all about. That's all the bean counters are interested in. One thing to be able to determine whether an engine needs reconditioning, but once you tell the customer it does, the first question you see, and his eyes usually bulge up a bit and he starts to get that tremble, is how much is this job going to cost? Now, that's a really good question, because it depends on how thorough you want to be with the reconditioning process on the engine. Now, some people won't go to the extent that we do, and depending on how you attack this, I'm of the belief that if you're going to do the job, it's a big job anyway, if you're going to do the job, you do it properly, and for a number of reasons. One is, you've got to try and give the customer something that's not going to fail or create a warranty problem. And as hard as you try, there'll always be one or two little glitches you run through with a reconditioned engine or a new engine. And that's just the way life is. But the costs that are involved, in doing a VDJ, your prices can vary between, say, $22,000 up to $29,000. And that depends on a number of things. You want to put a new radiator in the car. You want to put new injectors. You don't compromise. You want to put new glow plugs in. You want to put new timing chains in. You want to put all new gaskets, new pistons, rings, bearings, guide rails for your timing chain. And that's what a lot of people fail to realise. It's better to stick the extra $4,000 or $5,000 into the job initially. You'll get over the price over a period of time. You'll forget the price, but the one thing you won't forget is how well the engine runs. We're doing a lot of accessory changes with it. We're going to do a GVM upgrade on this. We're also going to reprogram the ECU to make the fuel delivery system more efficient. And that will produce two major outcomes. One will be a more efficient engine in its operation. So what we're going to achieve there is more power per given amount of fuel used, which equates to more power at the rear wheels of the car in terms of torque. For towing, we're going to experience about a 25% torque improvement on this, which will give you much better response when towing your caravan or camper trailer or excavator if you're a plumber or a tradie. There are other things you need to look at, and they are your clutch, your flywheel. We've got to grind the flywheel. In a reconditioned engine on a VDJ, we would include automatically an uprated clutch. One with about 860 newtons of clamping force on the actual clutch plate itself, or the driven plate as it's called. And that's because when we finish this engine and do the tuning on it, it's going to create a lot more torque, and the standard clutch just isn't good enough for an improved engine. So we'll remap the ECU, we'll put a new clutch on it, and then because the engine's a lot more responsive and the vehicle will accelerate a lot better and more comfortably, we'll also be doing a brake upgrade on it too. And you can never please everyone all the time and never 100%. But if you make it your mission to set out to do the right thing by people and give them good value for money, the best possible job you can do gives your customer the best possible outcome. And that's the reason that you go to a workshop, is the outcome. You want to go away with a smile. Sure, the cost of the job's going to hurt. And it is a lot of money. But try buying a new car.